Good evening, everyone. Hope this is coming through loud and clear. Nice to see a good gang here this evening. Except I'm moving on that computer and can't get the names over here. One second, let's see. So hello to Darius, Decaf, Smurf, Electro Skateboard, Infinicil, Ironic Viking, Median, and Vault 11. Good to have you here. Nice to have you here first time as well, Vault 11. It's cool. I think, wait a second, were you here first time? I'm losing track of who's who. I was getting some nice comments on YouTube as well of people wanting to turn up. All right, so I have not fixed the brightness stuff on the stream yet, so it's going to be a little darker than it should be. We'll just fudge and fiddle around with some things and get it working. What's been going on last week? Let's see. I did some fixes to Keppel over the weekend. So the bug that we saw at the beginning of last stream that stopped us using UBOs is fixed. It's actually kind of interesting. I might go on a little diversion here. Let's just bring up the drawing tool. Okay, so the detail was, here we go, the detail was that there's a peculiarity with how memory is laid out for shaders. So if you you can specify a few standards. Two of the ones that Keppel and Vario support are standard 140 and standard 430. Standard 430 is only available on slightly later GL versions. And they just tell you how much each type is going to take up and what its alignment is. And there's this nice peculiarity with this one, especially when you're dealing with a VEC3, in that, so a float takes up, let's say, one unit of space. VEC2 takes up two units. So it's one, two. And a VEC3 consumes three units, but it's aligned to four units, which is kind of interesting. A VEC4 consumes and is aligned to four units. So when you're laying out the memory, if you have a VEC2 and then a VEC3, it's going to be aligned to the place where a VEC4 normally would be. It means that a VEC3 followed by a float will take up, well, be packed next to each other. But if you had two VEC3s, there'll be a one unit gap, so a 4-byte gap. So yeah, there was just some peculiarities there. My layout code for Keppel that was working this stuff out was correct, but it was being used incorrectly by the structs in Keppel. It was aligning struct members based on their base offset in the GL terminology rather than their aligned offset. So yeah, there was some issues. So that got fixed. There were a few other things as well. Mostly like simple stuff, like just better error messages in a few cases. Some stuff we've run into on the stream. The upshot of all this is that we can make a UBO now for our lights. So if I, let's go, oh, one second before I do anything. We've got to commit things, prepare for stream, stream, and upload. I'm gonna go to episode 49, origin. Hope that was right. Maybe, yep, done, okay. I'm actually just gonna, so we don't have to deal with that again. Right, so yes, that was fixed. In the process of looking into some PBO stuff for another user, I found some horrible bugs in Keppel, which are just eating away at my mind at the moment. So basically, if you're creating multi-dimensional C or GPU arrays using Lisp data, like from the Lisp side, like they're probably wrong. We've got away with it with texture uploads because it's all the layouts have been handled by the C library. But if you like take a Lisp array and pass it straight to make C array, it'll look right, but its memory layout is all over the fucking shop. So I'm really disappointed in that. And just shows how little that part of the code base has been used. Again, there's barely any users, and I'm doing very particular things. Most of the time I'm just pulling in textures. The only time I really have multi-dimensional arrays, or if I'm using it just as a kind of data store and the where the element is inside the array doesn't matter so much as the content there. So yeah. Anyway. What's going on in chat? Darius is back. Sadly been busy for the last two streams. Yes, you've been missed, but it's good to have you here. Upon the Pimps is back as well and letting us know the AMD is okay. That's great. Vault 11 doesn't know Lisp either. Well, welcome, man. Feel free to ask questions. We are in no hurry to get through material. So ask, and people in the chat or myself will answer. We'll go through some bits. 25 degrees now in the evening. It's 29 at 8 in the evening. Jeepers creepers. Yeah, it is warm for Norway. It's pretty good. Do we have a starting branch? Oh yeah, you just saw it at the same time. Awesome. Right, so there's that. There was some other stuff I'm trying to remember as well. But oh yeah, I did some work on the FXAA stuff from the other week. So Nineveh now has FXAA 2 and FXAA 3. Let's just hop over to that code very quickly. Anti-aliasing, FXAA 2. One of the steps that you end up doing is, so the UVs you pass into FXAA 2 is actually a VEC 4. And there's a standard routine that you use to calculate those. But you don't need to do that in the fragment shader. It's kind of just as well that you do it in the vertex shader. And then let the GPU handle the interpolation for you. So there is this FXA calc UVs function, which generates the VEC4 that you need. So you just run this from vertex, pass that onto your fragment shader, and then you can call FXA from there. It's even easier in FXA 3. You're going to pass in the kind of UV and texture and a few other things, one over resolution, and a few parameters that are documented down here. But one of the things you've got to do is make sure that in your texture, you're packing your colors RGB, and then the last component needs to be the luma. And there are a variety of ways of calculating luma. The one we recommend using is actually provided, well, we've actually got a bunch of different, if I go to the color section, luminance, we have a bunch of functions already defined in Nineveh for calculating luminance in different ways. This is the one I've seen used in conjunction with FXAA stuff, so I recommend just using that. And then what we do is, if you just need something quick and dirty, we provide this function here called FXAA 3 pass, and you can just pass it a sampler and it will render a full screen, well, a full viewport, whatever your current viewport is, that's the size it's going to render, and it's going to do FXAA. So we actually use that already in our project here. So if we go back to play with it, we go down here, where's our rendering? Down here, okay. So we bind an FBO, we clear it, and then we render all of our objects into it, just these two at the moment. And then that's all been caught inside this FBO now. So then you get the sampler, which is actually this, which is sampling from the texture that is bound in this FBO. And we just pass it straight to FAA 3 pass from the Nineveh library. And that will just render stuff with the anti-aliasing. Not that it looks great right now, because I'm seeing some nasties down there. That doesn't look very anti-aliased. What the fuck's going on there? Okay. Something's clearly up. I'm going to need to look into that. that's not a great start. Oh, it's just jaggies. Very strange. Anyway... I'll have a peek at that soon. Actually, I can show you where we're setting things up for this. In our fragment stage, right at the end, just after we've done tone mapping, which we remember is also doing the gamma correction that we mentioned in the other weeks, we then call that luma function, giving it the final color. We get our luma, and then we pack final color and luma together in a VEC4. And that's what's then going into the texture, and so that's what's going to be passed to FXAA. Which is cool. Yes, because UBOs are now fixed again with VEC3s. Oh yeah, one last thing with that VEC3 stuff. Don't use VEC3s. I'm using them right now, but the general advice is steer clear of them, because different GPU driver implementations have screwed up in the past. It's one of those areas that, because it's kind of confusing in the spec, implementations get it wrong. And so if you just, basically, if you need to use a VEC3, just use a VEC4 and pack something different in that last value. That way, less likely for things to go wrong. But anyway, we're using them. Just as a reminder, so we've got this struct up here, which is a light set, which has an array of 30 lights and a count to say how many we're actually using from this right now. Each element of this array is a plight, which is one of these, has a position, a color, and a strength. And now, seeing as we've actually got UVOs working, rather than the hard coding of lights that we had last week, we extract the plights and count from the light set that's passed in, this guy here. We do times counts, so at the moment I've got that set to 2, so it's going to do this twice, and it just increments this vector 3 by whatever the result of the light function is, which is up here, which has all our attenuation and things in it. But yeah, that's that was that. In fact, why do we still have these here? Those aren't needed. Okay, that was the old hard-coded lights. So yeah, that's actually shorter now, which is nice. I will, let's just move this down to a new line, because we are very space limited here. And what are we gonna do? We're gonna go back to playwithverts.lisp. We will get started real soon. Like I say, I'm not worried about timing so much. I just wanted to show this UBO stuff a bit, seeing as it's working now, and that was gonna be part of the last episode. So it's a bit of a faff right now. When you make a UBO with Keppel, how it currently is shipping, or is currently in QuickLisp, it can either take a GPU array of length 1 with a specific type, or it can take just some Lisp data, which will transform into a GPU array. I don't know why only a GPU array. I would actually quite like to just be able to pass in a C array with one element in it as well. So I've done that on master now. It was just a tiny change. So that will work for UBOs and SSBOs. But right here, I'm just pretending we don't have that feature yet. So what we do is we're going to make a UBO which contains our light set, which was this type up here. So we make a C array, give it dimensions 1. We put in our light set. We say that our type is light set. We have no initial contents. Now, the reason I'm doing it like this is if you try and provide the initial contents, it's going to want all 30 lights. And I don't want to specify them right now. So all I'm doing is setting the array with no contents. Then I'm I'm getting the first element from that C array and calling it set. And then I'm getting the lights array out of that set as well. So we've got set is one of these, and plights is this array here, right? So then all we do is we set the count, which is this guy, to 2, and then we set the first element of the plights array to this light, and the second one to this light. So this guy is actually, it's way, way up, but if I bring it down to like 5 and put it around, I don't know, about 10? Yeah, let's do that. I actually take this down to 0. I'm gonna have to call the reset function, but then you can see our light is there. And so as soon as we recreated this UBO, the shader automatically obviously started, well, it was always drawing that light, but the light was way off. And now you can see it's an effect. It's effect, rather. Oh, words. But that's kind of cool. So I just wanted to show that is actually working now, and we do have, yeah, we have lights and we have all this stuff because UBOs are working a bit better. But, oh God, the array stuff, man, that's just kind of throwing me for 6. I'll rant about that more probably next week because I'll have the fix done by then. So yeah, and we really should actually get into the proper meat of this episode rather than just dicking around with stuff I've been fixing. So we have some normal mapping to do. In fact, one last thing, I will do a bit more dicking around. 1 second. I just want to put that green light out of the way again, because we will not be needing it. That anti-aliasing, or lack of anti-aliasing, is really bothering me. That's rubbish. I wonder what I did wrong. Anyway. Yeah, here we go. Okay, so we're just going to work through this tutorial and we're going to try and get some nicely normal mapped surfaces going. And it's going to get more complicated as we go down, hopefully. This first stuff is should be fairly simple. We'll see. Anyway. Okay, all of our scenes are filled with polygons, each consisting of hundreds or maybe thousands of flat triangles. We boosted the realism of by pasting 2D textures on these flat triangles to give them extra details, hiding the fact that the polygons actually consist of tiny flat triangles. So, yep, four big old triangles on the top of this guy, four over there, obviously four on each side. So yeah, for instance, take this bricks. Oh no, we skipped a bit, didn't we? Textures help, but when you look close at them, it's quite easy to see that the underlying flat surfaces. Most real life surfaces are not flat, however, and exhibit lots of bumpy details. So let's get right up in the face of this thing. Again, it is very flat. In fact, what we're gonna do is we're gonna put the same texture that he's been using on this. And while we're here, let's bump up the exposure and just see if that helps things for you. I mean, it's affecting the light, but oh, that might be an idea. Let's bring that down to 6 and just put this up at 8 or something. Yeah, that's a little better. Oh, actually, that's completely washed out the bottom. Fucking hell. Okay. Maybe not. Maybe we can just shove this up at 1. Anyway, we'll see soon enough. So, oh, I meant to have put the links in the chat. Oh, thank you, Meta Yan. You're a star. You beat me to it. That's great. So, actually, before we go any further, we're going to take this texture, which I've already downloaded, and put it on this thing over here. And so we're going to be really lazy about how we do this. Let's go and look at play with verts. We make a box. And the box has this scratched texture picked by default. In here, I have brickwall.jpg. So let's just swap this out and reset. Okay, there we are. There's our brick wall. And so, as he was saying, when we get up real close, we can see this is flat as a pancake. We don't get any other kind of light interacting with any of these details. So it looks really, really flat. It's kind of rubbish. We want to be able to do better than that. So, let's take this brick surface. It's quite rough, and obviously it's not completely flat. It contains sunken cement stripes and a lot of detailed little holes and cracks. If we were able to view such a brick surface in a lit scene, the immersion easily gets broken. But we can see a brick texture applied to a flat surface. Bam! By a point light, we have one of those floating around here somewhere, doing this lighting around there. The lighting does not. Oh, wait a second. I can just up the ambient light. That should help you guys a bit as well. Chris isn't distractible. No! We haven't learned this from many, many episodes of me just going, oh, another thing. Oh! Why is the ambient doing so little? It is still rendering. Yeah. One! Oh, wow. The tone mapping must be really taking control of that. Oh, well, the scene's a bit easier to see now. Okay. Anyway, let's start with this. Wow, that's really interesting. Okay, I can feel a sneeze coming. It's just bugging the shit out of me. Right, okay. Okay. The lighting does not take any of the small cracks and holes into account and completely ignores the deep stripes between the bricks. And I've completely ignored the fact that this is probably a little hard to read. So let's zoom in and do this because we want to be comfortable when doing this nonsense. We're not doing this for fun. This isn't fun. Right. Okay, we can partly solve the flatness by using a specular map to pretend some surfaces are less lit or due to depth or other details, blech. But that's more than a hack than a real solution. Definitely sounds like it. What we need is some way to inform the lighting system about all the little depth-like details in the surface. And now we go on to talk about the fact that about the kind of texture of things. So if we think about this from light perspective, how does the surface how come the surface is lit as a completely flat surface? The answer is the surface is normal vector. So we've got these normal, we have a normal pointing out from here. If I were to, oh, I guess I stopped Chrome it. Okay. I'll start the doodle device again later. We don't need it yet. From the lighting algorithm's point of view, the only way it determines the shape of an object is by the perpendicular normal vector. Remember, we take in our lighting equation, our very, very basic lighting equation, we take the normal and we take the direction to the light, and we do a dot product between those two vectors, and that gives us the cosine of the angle between them. But the important thing is we get a number between 0 and 1, which is related to the angle between the light and the surface, which is really cool because we want to spread the light out, we reduce the amount of light energy when it's closer to perpendicular, because that emulates how light gets kind of spread across the surface when it's coming in at that kind of acute angle. The brick surface only has a single normal vector, and as a result, the surface is uniformly lit based on the normal vector's direction. What if we, our little graphic engineers that we are pretending to be, what if we, instead of a per surface normal that is the same for each fragment, use a per fragment normal is different for every fragment? This way we can slightly deviate the normal vector based on a surface's little details. As a result, this gives the illusion the surface is a lot more complex. So the idea is, yes, we are going to have a texture, and just like we use texture to give ourselves more than just one color per vertex, and we put colors all the way across the triangles, we're going to do this to change the normal all the way across these triangles, and hopefully our lighting system will then make it just look a little bit better. We'll see. By using per fragment normals, we can trick the lighting into believing the surface consists of lots of tiny little planes perpendicular to the normal vectors, giving the surface an enormous boost in detail. So this is, oh, look at that transformation. Yeah, we'll see. I shouldn't be this cynical, but yes, it's going to work. It'll be fine. This is the easy bit. This technique to use per fragment normals compared to the per surface normals is called normal mapping or bump mapping. Normal mapping's better. Applying the brick plane, it looks like this. Okay, so, oh, look, success. These two pictures are definitely proof. So to get normal mapping, we're going to need a per fragment normal. Similar to what we did with diffuse maps and specular maps, we can use 2D texture to store the per fragment data. So we're going to need a texture like this, which is storing normals. So what we're going to do is, rather than your textures have like four components, well, four or three, we're going to be reading four. R, G, B, and normally we use the fourth one for like alpha or something like this. But they're just numbers, like they can be used for anything. We have a two-dimensional array of VEC4s. We can store any data in there. So instead of RGB, we'll do XYZ. And now we have a direction. So that will be cool. And that's what this is. This is, rather, these colors look strange because it's actually storing a direction, or a normal in this case. Let's have a look. Well, normal vectors are geometric entities, and textures are generally used for color information, basically things I've said. We can simply store the normals X, Y, and Z components in the respective color components. Normal vectors range between minus 1 and 1, so they're first mapped to 0 and 1. So, yes, we're going to need to make sure when we read it out of the texture that we transform it back to the minus 1 to 1 range. With normal vectors transformed to an RGB color component like this, we can store a per fragment normal derived from the shape of the surface onto the 2D texture. An example normal map of the brick surface at the start of this tutorial is shown below. Boop! And we have just that texture back here. Brick wall normal. There it is. So we are going to need that. And we are going to need to attach it to our object as well. So let's go and look at the things file where we define these types. Here's our box. So let's normals. We'll just call it normals. The init form is going to be we're going to get text. And actually, this box now will already have this. When you redefine a class in common-lisp, all the instances get updated, and this is used to set the initial value. And so, yeah, that will now have that available. But lots of our objects do not have a normal map. So how are we going to do this? Because we're going to have our rendering, like our shaders, are going to be expecting a normal map. So I think we're going to have to split them in two. We're inheriting from a thing. This is the thing type. Let's have just thing with normals. Oops. Is it just down here? Yeah, it was, wasn't it? I want to take this. And I want to specify that this is the additional data in this. So thing with normals is going to inherit from thing and is also going to add this field. And then we are going to go down to box again, which is down way, oh yeah, here. And we are going to inherit from thing with normals. And then we're just going to override sampler to give it a default, and we've overridden normals to give it a default. So again, we've redefined that type. So Lisp was just so nice for that. It's so forgiving. If we look at the things list, we have a box, and it has as well as a sampler that we're using for the albedo, the normal color that we're putting across the surface. We now have a sampler that's for a texture that is holding our normal map, which is awesome. But not every thing that gets made is a thing with normals, so we're going to need to be able to render both of those separately. So if we just go to the render file, let's just copy this. Oh no, wait a second. Let's take this bit. We got the sum frag stage, but we need the sum vert stage. There it is. And we're just going to rename this as vert stage with norms. And then sum frag stage, we're going to do the same thing. So sum frag stage is going to be frag stage with norms. Instead of pipeline, some pipeline, this is some pipeline with norms. Oh, I didn't like that. Oh, that's why it's saying that most likely it means, like it says, it can't find this. Most likely means it hasn't been compiled yet. And it's correct, it has not been compiled yet. So let's go here and compile. There's a GPU function here. And this pipeline. Cool. So now we've got a separate pipeline that we're going to modify. This is the code we're going to modify to support normal mapping. And now if we go back to things and we look for the draw method, we're going to make a new version of the draw method that instead of specializing on thing is going to specialize on thing with normals. And right now it's exactly the same. Kind of interesting, actually. We do this in a kind of gash way right now. I just realized that we pass in the pipeline to draw. Let's see how that looks. Where is it? That's reset, not reset, down here. Yeah, so we pass in, when we're calling draw, we pass in the pipeline. I don't like that anymore. We're going to remove that, but before I compile it, I want to go and change this thing up here. What we're going to do is we're just going to say its pipeline is this. And then in thing with normals, we're going to change it to some pipeline with norms. And now when we define our draw function, we can just extract pipeline from that. In fact, it's kind of pointless because that's actually wrong as well. This is I'm not thinking. if we're specializing on a thing and we know that the thing is going to be using some pipeline, then we can just use some pipeline directly here. And this one, we can just directly put the some pipeline with norms thing. Right, and that means I'm going to go back up here, remove the pipeline, remove the pipeline. Again, just being able to change, make mistakes, and not have to stop your code is really nice. Okay, so we've made a new subclass of thing called a thing with normals. We've specialized the draw function to now call this separate pipeline, which is where we're going to handle all our normal mapping stuff. So let's save this. I will prepare for norms. Push that. Keep our illustrious Meta Yan happy, who's always on top of this, which I love. It's really good. Okay. Da-da-da-da-da. So it says this, and almost all normal maps you find online will have a bluish tint. This is because all the normals are closely pointing outwards towards the positive Z axis. So Z, remember, it's RGB, so XYZ. B is going to be the Z component. And because it's going to be positive in this case, it's going to be pointing away from the surface, we're going to have that bluish tint. And then you're going to see the reds and the greens kick in where we're at different angles. Darius is way ahead of us, saying that normals are all easy till you need tangent stuff to transform the normal texture. Absolutely, and that's where I'm hoping we'll get to in this tutorial. I want to get to do some triplanar mapping very soon. There's a couple of shader effects that would be really nice to do. So I want to do an episode on that. For us to do that, we really need to have kind of the tangent space normals and all that kind of tangents and bitangents all squared away in our heads. And I certainly don't have them there yet. So this is this first part, at least, is just a refresh. And then the tangents and bitangents stuff is stuff I really need to get right. It's going to be fun. It's going to be fun. We've got so much. Like, I'm not stopping these episodes anytime soon. I hope we can get quite far and do some quite cool effects. But obviously, the deeper we go, when we get to some of the more advanced techniques, to get the speed and all those things, you have more, like, prerequisites in your pipeline. Like when you get into stuff like temporal anti-aliasing, there's all these other things that you're going to need your pipeline to be able to provide to you so you can do that properly. And that makes it quite hard to do like single episodes on it. It's a bit tricky. I'm trying to have a bit of a dependency graph, and I need at least a recap, if not a complete relearn of everything. So it's going to be fun. So back to the chat. Let's see what's going on. Dare I say, not worried about timing so much. Mark his words. Let's make an 8-hour stream from Pond to Pip Thou. Dude, we could do that one day. But, I mean, I don't mind hanging out on a weekend sometime. But Median's, again, already anticipating me pushing stuff. This is really cool, Matt. You don't have to apologize for anything. You're being awesome. Don't worry about it. Everyone in the chat's badass. So Flynn, or FL Lynn in chat, is saying both defer methods are called draw. How should it be? What we're doing there is we're specializing on a different type. So if you call draw and pass in an instance of thing, you're going to call this method. If you call draw and pass in an instance of thing with normals, it's going to call this method. So this is your kind of... Why is that gone right out of my head on what that is? Again, like your overloading and stuff from C# or Java. Starting clean gives the function play with verts draw requires at least 3 arguments. Shit, you're right, sir. And I know exactly why, because remember when I said I won't compile that thing yet? Oh dear. So, we need to finish off this. We don't take pipeline anymore. Now that's freaking out. That's the argument that Metian has just seen. We go to render. Let's bring that error up over here, because we're going to need that. We can look for draw. Oh no, not render, sorry. Play with verts, that's the file. Here's draw. And we removed the pipeline, so I'm going to recompile that. Invalid number of arguments, 2. I disagree. What doesn't it like? Continue? No. Right, so let's go back to SLDB. Oh, we've got a few errors up now. Okay. Oh, right. So once a method is defined, this is one of those kind of slightly fiddly things, but all right once you know it. Once a method is defined, all of the overloads, what's the correct term for that? Once you've defined a generic function with, say, 3 arguments, all of the methods that implement that generic function have to have 3 arguments. You can't change that very easily unless you unbind the method first. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to inspect. I'm doing control. How do I do that? It's all kind of muscle memory. Control C, Shift I. So Control C, capital I is inspect, or you can just do slime inspect. We're going to inspect the draw symbol. So let's do that. Oh, wait, so the variable draw is unbound. Okay. Of course, it needs to be quote draw because it says it's going to evaluate it. We inspect this symbol and we see here that it's a function that's bound to this generic function. And so what we're going to do is we're going to unbind it. So basically we've just, that method no longer exists. So now when I redefine it, it doesn't complain. And that can go away. And then we can say continue. And why does it not like this? Takes 3 required arguments. It was asked to find a method with specializers. Is that an old one? I'm a little confused on where we are now. Let's have a look. Are we still drawing? We are still drawing. Okay, so something's happy. We recompile things, recompile render. Holy shit, that was a lot of logs. But we're still going. Okay, so that is done. What I'll do is just... Whoops, forgot to remove the arg from draw. Sorry about that, Madigan. Thanks for keeping on top of that. Noise. At W Games, good morning. Thank you for keeping Lisp alive. I'm not keeping it alive. I'm just playing and having fun. Lisp ever dies, I don't think mankind will survive. It just won't be as much fun. It'd just be a shame. Right. Have a look what's going on. Maybe new push. I did. Didn't I push? Probably we got a little bit of lag between us. Anyway, where are we? I've forgotten. Okay, so we should be drawing now. Let's just make sure that we pass that sampler up to our new pipeline. So we're going to be doing things with this in this stage. It's just relay that out. Normal map is going to be a sampler 2D. So we set that uniform and we've recompiled. Now we're going to go back to our things file, and in the draw for things with normals, we're going to pass up our normal map, and it is going to be... You know what? I don't think we have an accessor for this yet. No. We need to define a method that lets us access the access the value. So we're going to say accessor, and we're just going to call it normals. I think that's all right. Is there a function defined for that already? I'm clicking the wrong buttons. Let's inspect. No function value. Cool. So we're safe to use that. Right, and then here we're just going to say normals of thing. Okay, so now that should be being passed up to our pipeline, to our shaders. And so one thing we could just do to test this is if we take the normal map and just ignore all this color stuff, and we just say, we'll just say that the final color is, we're going to sample the normal map using the UV. And boom, it does not like it. Why doesn't it like it? Ah, because that's going to return a vec4, and we're expecting final color to be a vec3.
So,
we're going to just go and abort this. We're going to swizzle, and we're just going to take, oops, if I can click the right button, X, Y, and Z. There we go. Okay, so now this is our normal map. And we're displaying it as a texture right now. We're just showing what it is. And so now we're happy that it's there. Let's just comment this out, recompile, and we're back to our proper texture. Okay, so back to the tutorials. This and almost all normal maps you'll find online have a bluish tint. That was the bit we read before. But it is worth remembering that these are all pointing mostly in one direction. So what if we wrap them around an object that's like a sphere that is all the normals are facing in different directions? How's that going to work? We are going to see. Okay, with a simple plane looking in the positive Z axis, like this one right here, we can take this diffuse texture and this normal map to render the image from the previous section. Note that the linked normal map is different from the one shown above. The reason for this is that OpenGL reads texture coordinates with the V or with the W or V coordinates reversed from how textures are generally created. The linked normal map thus has its Y or green component reversed. Oh. You can see the green colors are now pointing downwards. If you fail to take this into account, the lighting will be incorrect. Load both textures, bind them to the proper texture units, and render a plane with the following lighting changes in the lighting fragment shader. So, this is reading the value out of the texture, and then this is multiplying by 2 and minusing 1, which is remap. We've done this before. So let's take this. Boop. And we'll just shove it around here somewhere. Let's just pop it right here. We'll comment it out. We'll line some things up. And then we'll go and implement it. So, we'll probably end up ignoring this a bit. So let's just do, norm from map. It's quite a long name, but it'll do. We're going to call texture on our normal map. And we're going to be using our UV, which is great. And yes, just like we did further down, we're going to have to swizzle it with X, Y, Z. That's, you can see dot here, dot RGB. When swizzling, you can use RGB or X, Y, Z or STV? I think that's it. But you can't mix and match them. So you can't do R, Y, Z, for example. I always prefer using X, Y, Z, even when it comes to colors, because I don't know why, it maps better in my head. I much prefer it. Anyway, we do this. And then we can go norm from map is going to be norm from map multiplied by 2 minus 1. So we compile that, no change because we're not using this value for anything yet. But then what we're going to do is in the place we used to use normal, we're going to swap it out with norm from map, and hopefully things look slightly different. So, what have we got going on here? Well, there's one thing you can see that, like, now there's seems to be a lot of detail around here. On side on, you're still going to see the issues, but let's make this easy to swap out. What should we do? What if? Let's just have a, I'm just going to have a quick play with something. If we took the time now, and we took the sine of that, and then we stepped on that. What's the arguments to step again? You pass an edge and a value, so we'll pass 0. So every time sine is above 0, it's the result value from this is going to be 1. Is that what I want? To be honest, I can just do normal if sine of now is greater than zero. Let's just do it like this. Normal. Oops. Otherwise, norm from map. So there we go. Normal. Normal, and hopefully, yes, every second we'll switch between one implementation and the other. Now, it's quite a bit of weird stuff going on here, because this whole area seems to think it's in shadow, which is very wrong. So I'm not sure what's quite going on there yet. I'm just going to go and look at the assets file where we load in the textures. And I want to make sure that... Where's texture? We're not doing anything funky here when we load things in. No, we just load image to texture. Oh, interesting. We're using sRGB. Oh, wow, that's actually super wrong. Crap, I'd forgotten we were doing that. That's really bad. And it's really bad because... that means every time we pull it in, it's getting gamma corrected, even though it's not meant to be. Like, even though we're using it for normal values. That's a terrible decision. And albedo, and we're gamma correcting once it's in. Oh, that's just a mess. That's completely wrong. Oh, dear. All right, okay, so... That's kind of disappointing, because that means that a lot of the stuff last week was incorrect as well, as far as the texture, how the textures looked. That could explain some things. Yes, that could explain some kind of jankiness. All right, let's... oh, dear. Right, let's go and tell everything to reload. But before we do that, we're going to have to go back to assets, and I want to go and clear this. So if I look at samplers, yep, we got some four things in there. Let's just go and inspect it. A bunch of samplers with a bunch of textures. I think I'm just going to leak them for now, because that's what I'm going to do. And then I'm going to say reset, and then hopefully, oh Christ, yeah, good point. I should actually have set that to... hash table. Oh dear. Right. Do that. And then, what am I doing here? Retry. Oh, okay. Yes. Now values are very different. Oh, man. Okay. So when we load them in, we are then gamma correcting them. Then a lot of these values here are probably quite off. Right, our lights are very bright, so let's just go back into play with vert and turn those down a bit. I wonder why they could be so bright, because everything was wrong. So 1000, and well, it doesn't matter what this one is, because it's miles away, but let's tone this down a bit. Okay, at least we're not getting horrendous shadows when we're switching technique now. Ugh, right. It is so hot today. Right. Now what are we going to do? Now we're going to save that, because that was broken. And Metian, I will push soon. I can almost feel you asking, but I just need to... unscrew some of this stuff first. Let's put this back up towards one and see how bright that is. I'm going to turn the ambient down because we've got way too much ambient now. Let's just turn ambient off. Oof, Jesus. That's crazy. It means we've got... Oh, no, wait. Oh, I'm an idiot. One second. So... We actually really should be, because we've got two separate pipelines now, we should be sharing the values between them. How's the best way of doing this? Well, I know the laziest way of doing it. Def exposure is 0.1. And we'll definitely make sure that's a single float. And we're going to take exposure and put it here, wherever this is. Okay, there's that. And then we're going to use exposure up here as well. Okay, there we go. And we're going to do the same with ambient. So ambient is, what have we got it set to right now? We've got it set to 0. So let's go and put 0 here. Put the ambient. We could just pass this up. We could make uniforms here. This function is, what we're using here is a feature from Vario called implicit uniforms. If it can see a globally scoped, for lack of a better term, variable, and it can work out the type of it, it will create a uniform for you. So then you can just use special variables from within side shaders, which is handy. Why is ambient a vec3 there? That's kind of interesting. Good. Okay, so now we should be able to go here and if we set ambient up, doesn't react. Oh, that's kind of disappointing. Huh. Trying to work out why that wouldn't have any effect. Does exposure do anything? Wow, that's almost like something's broken. Oh, now I'm gonna have to think about this because that shouldn't be. It's almost like it's baking the value into the shader, and if I set the ambient to 1.3 and then recompile this, or recompile this, no, oops, sorry, I'm in this one. No, it's not having any effect. What the fuck, man? That is very annoying. Okay, let's pull the pipeline and see what's going on. I want to see what the GLSL code we got generated was. So here's ambient, which is vec3. Are we actually using it in the equation? I'm pretty sure we are. Yeah, ambient is add to diffuse power. That gives us our light amount, which we then use to multiply the albedo and yada yada yada. We've got things going on there. What the? Why is there a 0 here? That was odd. Is that mistake up here too? It is. Don't like that. But that didn't have any impact. So yeah, we pull. We get to see that ambient is a vec3 that is being pulled from this here, 42 ambient 42. That'll be the char code for earmuffs for the asterisks. So here we can see the uniform ambient. So why aren't you changing? I need to work this out before we go any further, because I want to be able to tweak exposure and stuff. And I think our lighting's wrong as well, just on top of everything else. Because I'm seeing quite heavy shadows down. Oh, maybe it's okay. Just trying to think of where actually the shadows are falling, and if it makes sense given the light position. We'll move the light and we'll see how it responds. But yeah, that's a uniform that's been added. There is an implicit uniform there. And it is being used in this code down here. So I don't know exactly what's going on. So I'm going to get into some nastiness now. I'm going to expand this macro and have a look at what happened. Ambient. There's got to be... Where's the uniform uploading? Implicit uniform upload func. Oh yeah, it's part of the pipeline state. Implicit. Very strange. Alright. I guess, I mean, this isn't entirely terrible. Like, this is somewhere where at least we've got some lighting now and we can work with this. But I'm rather disconcerted by some of these issues that we've been seeing. Really bummed out about the textures from last week being just straight up wrong. That's very annoying. So I was so happy with how they looked. Or at least how the lights looked on them. I guess we kind of compensated for the lights for the textures being wrong, and the fall off was still correct. So, oh well. Let's call reset and I had a reason, but I can't remember what it was. Okay. All right, back to work. I guess I've got to file an issue. Would someone mind doing that for me? Would someone just file a little issue saying implicit uniforms and Keppel seem not to be working, and just mention this episode? Right. Anyway, let's see what's been going on in the chat. Thank you so much. Defvar won't overwrite. You must use setf, right? Yes, I. You saved the day. You're absolutely right. All this worry, I'm looking through code and I should have just looked at chat. You muppet. Def parameter. Ambient. Let's set ambient to 1 now. Oh, look at that. Lots of ambient light. It just works like it's made by someone who knows what they're doing. It's definitely not made by someone who knows what they're doing. Okay, so that's off. And the exposure now we can control with this as well. So yeah, let's go like that. Oops. Thank you so much, Darius. I'm such a muppet. Yeah, I can see there's all these comments saying, SETF! SETF or def parameter. Pawn to pivot. Yeah. Yeah, it's absolutely right. I have been saved. Many, yeah, we should have a bet. This is so good. Oh, we should have a bell. Oh, you should have a bell. That's a good idea. We should set something up so you can get my attention. And I've been sitting here monologuing about how everything's broken, and you've been sitting there just going, ah! It works fine! Right, okay. Let's see how long it takes until he checks our chat. A while, dude. It was a while. It was like 5 minutes. Oh no, he's off doing nasty stuff. Oh, don't contact me on Twitter. I'm so bad at checking my Twitter. It'll be weeks before I see it. Open an issue on GitHub. I might catch it. By Saturday, probably. That moment of realization. Oh, God. Amazing. Okay, right. Oh. I'm a muppet. Oh, well. Okay, let's get back to business. I'm going to just offset this position by... of course, we're going to throw sign in here, because we always do. Sign of now. Times something. Let's just get. I thought plus 10 brought that up. Position plus. A Let's bring this down. Hold on. What? I'm doing another weird one here. Oh, wait. Yep. Another idiot. That's okay. I'm changing the position of the fragment and not the position of the actual light. Which will not help. It will not help you. It will not save the day. Like, let's do this. Let's just pass now into calculite. We'll make a new overload that takes now. And it's a float. Deary me. It's not boding well for this episode, is it? Right. Let's look at calculite. Where is that called? It's called here. And it's called here. Now we can go back to calculite and we're gonna just change its position. Let's replace this with pos. We're just doing this so we can fudge with it. Right, now we've got that, let's go back down to our rendering with normals, and let's take this out for now. We're just gonna comment this out and just say the normal is normal from map. Let's go and have a look at what we ended up with here. Okay, so I don't think that's too bad. As the light passes over, you can see that the light is falling into the gaps, and then we get shadow. What's strange, though, is it seems like we got shadows. They almost look like they're in the wrong direction, right? Like, I'm getting darker shadows down here. Like, watch the light go past. And then this is still bright, but this is darker. That looks wrong, doesn't it? I'll zoom in a bit more for you. But as it goes past, we do get... I don't know, maybe that's the fall off from this area? Or that's what it's simulating? I don't know. But he did mention this whole Y component thing. So OpenGL reads texture coordinates with Y or V coordinates reversed from how textures are generally created. The linked normal map has its Y or green component reversed, so you can see the colors are now pointing downwards. If you fail to take this into account, your lighting will be incorrect. So that would mean that when we're reading from here, our UV would be slightly different. Let's make a normal UV, and let's just do, it'll be the X from UV and 1 minus the Y of UV. So let's do NUV and have a look at that. That is not what I expected. Okay, maybe we were fine. Anyway, I took the... Yeah, the bright's down the bottom there. And here the bright's on the top. But I took the normal map straight from his GitHub repo. So yeah, we've got the brightness on the bottom. So we're using the flipped version that he's talking about. So I guess we were already correct there. I was just worried that he meant that when you read the component out... I guess this isn't what I need to think about. I was wondering if the y component was flipped or something like this, which would mean like x x of normal from map one minus y. Actually, no, that doesn't make any sense. No, it's fine. I suppose you could say it was negated or something like this. Negative y of norm from map and z norm from map. So that's annoying because that kind of looks better in some ways. Because the light goes down and you get shadows up here. And when the light passes, it still fills out. Yeah. I think I need to read that paragraph again. What do you think? It's as if the texture is switching, or is it the stream compression? Oh yeah, sorry, that's the map switching that we were doing before. Yeah, now it's correct with inverted y. Okay, that's interesting. So that's the bit I need to reread this again, because I just find the way he's worded this kind of strange. It's different from the one shown above. The reason is that the OpenGL reads texture coordinates with the y. Reads texture coordinates with the y or v coordinates reversed from how textures are generally created. The linked normal map thus has its y or green component reversed. That's strange. I'm going to go and check out his GitHub repo. Let's have a look. Learn OpenGL GitHub. And let's go and have a look at the source. Because I find it strange that you're flipping the Y coordinate once it's loaded in. That seems wrong. It's meant to be the easy bit. What am I at? 9 o'clock? That's okay. So here's his normal map. Let's copy that and search. Yeah, we load in the normal. We normalize. Oh, that's something we're not doing, is it? Did I not do that? Oh, that's not going to be good. I mean, it won't flip the direction entirely, but... Maybe if we write def var in the chat, it would possibly to play something like, and then it's just a link to the alarm danger warning sound. Oh man, yeah, we'll have to hook up something. That's awesome. Guess that's due to your texture loader. It's flipping Y for your UVs. Yeah, but... Okay, so let's have a look. Okay, so, oh right, okay, so the both textures are flipped and thus the normals are incorrect. So we're having to flip the Y. Man, that is janky, isn't it? That is interesting. But I want to see where he compensates for that in this. Because he loads it in, he remaps it. And then he never speaks of it again. Well, no, he just starts using it for calculations. No manipulating of the value once it's in. Omnipim is actually listening to that alarm sound for way too long while deciding it's annoying. So yeah, I'm struggling to understand the whole, like, yes, struggling to understand this bit. It's such a simple thing. We may skip past it and just, so Darius, were you saying that you think that we want this this line here? Because I do agree that the shadows look better with it. Let's have a look. Where did we get to? We'll go through this one last time. Note that the linked normal map is different from the one shown above. The reason is that OpenGL reads texture coordinates with the V or, the Y or V coordinates, UV coordinates, reversed from how textures are generally created. So it's going to be flipped upside down. The linked normal map thus has its Y or green component reversed. You can see the green colors are now pointing downwards. Oh yeah, if you fail to take this account. So we should really just flip both of our textures in general. Like the texture chords we could just flip. Wait, maybe he's doing that in his vertex shader. Where's his out? Text chords. Text chords equals a text chords. No, so he's just taking the text chords he's got in and flipping them and just passing them straight on. No changes. So unless he's already fixed them, which is possible. Yeah, that could actually be a problem. I don't know though. So yeah, we could just flip our UVs for the whole thing. Yeah, let's do it. So we're just gonna, take our UV and, do exactly what we did before. Take the X of UV and take one minus the Y of UV. And in the vertex stage, we can just flip our UVs. In fact, seeing as there's nothing different with our vertex stages between these two, let's just get rid of this one and tell this one just to use vert stage. Oh, was it called sumvert or something like this? Some vert stage, yeah. There we go. And then down in here, we no longer have to do this flip, hopefully. Unless I'm being really stupid. Okay, yeah. Now that's getting the shadows where we want it. Nice. Cool. That took way too long, but we're done. Thanks, Darius. I was like... I end up doubting myself with this so much because I look at something and like very aware that I haven't got the eye for any of this. But yeah, okay, so we're getting a lot of what looks like detail. Looks like we've got extra geometry here, but all we're doing is we're faking it with the lighting. Shadows tell us so much about the texture of things, and just by manipulating the normal, then we're able to make it look like there's a lot more physical detail without adding any more triangles. Of course, the illusion is broken as soon as you go side on. And you can see that it's still totally flat. But from the angle you're normally viewing stuff, it looks better. Just as a reminder, the other normal made it look like this. Which is super flat. So from that to this is a pretty good win. Cool. Right, let's see if we can actually make some progress through this now, because I've made us very slow. Okay, so here we reverse the process of mapping normals to RGB colors by remapping them back from 0 to 1. We've done that already. By slowly moving the light, you really get a sense of depth using normal map. Running this normal mapping example gives exactly these results. Hurrah! There's one issue that greatly limits this use of normal maps. The normal map we have used had vectors that all roughly pointed in the Z direction, so out towards us, like roughly here going this way. However, what would happen if we use the same normal map on the plane lying on the ground with a surface normal pointing in the Y direction? It's gonna look like shit. Let's do it. We can't just take their word for it. We have to do it. So let's go find our box. This is our wall right now. Let's make another one. Let's get rid of the ground for a bit. And this one, actually, we're gonna make both. Let's have this, we'll get rid of the ground, and we'll make one of these is just going to be at 0, 0, 0. And it's gonna be 30, 31, there we go. And let's zoom out so we can see it actually happen. Say reset, and yeah, that looks very wrong. It's also difficult because the light's way out the way. So let's, I'm actually gonna make it 40 by 40 because it will fit better with what we had before. Now let's go and mess with that light. Whereas this is controlling its origin position. Hey, in fact, we could bring this other one down. Let's just put this one at 0, 4, 0. Or actually a little further forward, 5. We're gonna make it white just like the other one, and we are going to give it roughly the same power. Let's do 300 and let's do reset. And now that is very strange, right? Let's move this guy out of the way just to see that this was, there is something up with that light. Let's put it at 10. Yeah, the lighting is all fucked. This isn't even vaguely resembling. We've got a light hovering around here. It is moving up and down though. That is a good point. So because of our little hackery, let's just put it at 15. But even then, like it's hovering up and down here. So yeah, this looks completely wrong. It is, because all the normals are still pointing in this direction, like out of here. So we need to be able to rotate our normals to actually match the surface. And that's where we're getting next. So let's do this. Right. Actually, we will bring this down again to, I'm very indecisive with this stuff. 0, 4, 0, and, or 5 rather. We're going to go back to render, and we're going to turn off that wiggle. Where is it? Okay. And again, just to get an idea of what this should be looking like, if we go down to our normal things and switch out for the normal, the regular normal, we can see things look a lot more balanced. Let's actually leave it in this mode and set up our light how we want them to be while we can actually see its effect correctly. And then, where is it? Down here. And then we'll carry on. I want to move it to 10. I want to disable this light for a second, so I'm going to move it up to 500 again. Where's this light? Oh yeah, I've turned down the power again, that's why. So there. There it is. Let's move it nice and close to the surface. Yes, we got that good fall off. Let's drop its power down. No, actually, I didn't want to do that. Probably even lower. There we go. That's what I wanted. Something like that. Nice little point light. And now I'll bring this one back. Okay. And then we go back to our shader and we go and put our normals again, and you can see actually there is the point light here, and then all these are screwed up. This one looks okay, this one looks terrible, because we're using the same normal maps for two different orientations. Cool. And I've obviously missed something. Marianne, we didn't get a push. Sorry, dude. Right, let's do that now. I was busy breaking things for a while, so it's a good time to do this. Normals. Look bad on the floor. There we go. Excellent. Now, back to the guide. Okay, so everything looks wrong. It's because the sampled normals of this plane still roughly still point roughly in the positive z direction, even though they should point somewhere in the positive y direction of the surface normal. As a result, the lighting thinks the surface normals are the same as they were as before when the surface was still looking in the positive z direction. Yeah, okay, so it's still thinking it's pointing this way, but they should be pointing roughly that way. So yeah, all of our normals are pointing in this kind of direction. Okay. Then he suggests some crazy idea, like having six different normal maps with different orientations, but that makes no sense. A different but slightly more difficult solution that works by doing lighting in different coordinate space. A coordinate space where the normal map vectors always point roughly in the positive z direction. All of the other lighting vectors are then transformed relative to this positive z direction. This way we can always use the same normal map regardless of orientation. This coordinate space is called tangent space. Cool. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to make a space across, I suppose, for every fragment, where positive z is in the direction of the surface normal. And then I suppose that the trick is getting good tangents, is getting the good x and y components of your new space, which would be your, I guess, your tangent and bitangent stuff, getting those correct. Let's have a look. Tangent space. Finally, here we go. Normal vectors in a normal map are expressed in tangent space, where normals always point roughly towards the positive z direction. Tangent space is a space that's local to the surface of the triangle. Yeah, cool. All right. The normals are relative to the local reference frame of the individual triangles. Think of it as a local space for the normal map's vectors. That sounds cool. They're all defined pointing in the positive z direction regardless of the final direction, final transform direction. Using a specified matrix, we can then transform normal vectors from this local tangent space to world or view coordinates, orienting them along the final mapped surface's direction. So, we've got a diagram here. Yeah. So we're going to make... Let's bring up eShell, bring up grommet, switch back to what we had before. So in my head, what's going to happen is we're going to make little coordinate spaces where this is like Z, X, and Y. For all, I'm not sure if it's all fragments or just all vertices, and then they're interpolated across the fragments. And then for here, so this would be Z. And this might be X. And this might be Y. We're going to see. But then all of our normals are defined in this coordinate system, in this space. And all of the lighting should work better. Which is nice. Let's hope. Oh, my stomach is rumbling something fierce right now. Just had a big old chili. Should be fine. Maybe that's the problem. Oh, dear. Anyway, let's have a look. Enough about my stomach. I actually need some water. That's what I need. God damn, it's 9:30 already. Taking way too long. Uh, Okay, so the normal map is defined in tangent space. So the only way to solve the problem is to calculate a matrix to transform normals from tangent space into different space such that they're aligned with the surface's normal direction. The normal vectors are then all pointing roughly in the positive y direction in this flat floor case. The great thing about tangent space is we can calculate such a matrix for any type of surface so that we can properly align the tangent space's z directions to the surface's normal direction. Such a matrix is a TBN matrix, where the letters depict a tangent, bitangent, and normal vector. These are vectors. These are the vectors we need to construct this matrix. To construct such a change of basis matrix that transforms a tangent space vector to a different coordinate space, we need three perpendicular vectors. We're going to be doing cross products here. We know that for sure. That are aligned along the surface of a normal map. An up, right, and forward vector. Similar to what we did in the camera tutorial. We already know the up vector, which is the surface's normal vector, the right and forward vector, that tangent and bitangent vector respectively. The following image on a surface shows all three. And that, I suppose the tricky bit is, again, like there are infinite solutions to where tangent and bitangent could be. They could be here and here. As long as, and it could be, the tangent could be this way and the bitangent this way. As long as they're orthogonal to all three other bases, then every single one is valid. Okay, so calculating the tangent and bitangent vectors is not as straightforward as the normal vector. We can see from the image that the direction of the normal map's tangent and bitangent vector align with the direction in which we define a surface's texture coordinates. Huh, that's a good point. We'll use this fact to calculate tangent and bitangent vectors for each surface. Retrieving them does a bit of math. Take a look at the following image. Okay, so given that you know the UVs at the points, you should be able to work out your orientation here. Oh, that's interesting. So which two do you pick? Does it matter? Probably doesn't. No. Okay, from the image we can see the texture's coordinates. This is going to be difficult to read. Because I'm not good with, I guess triangle is polygon, or triangle in this. We'll see. From the image, we can see the texture coordinate differences of an edge E2 of a triangle denote as, here we go, triangle U2 and V2 are expressed in the same direction as the tangent vector T and the bitangent vector B. If anyone knows what this actually stands for, do let me know, because I don't want it to go Googling right now. Because of this, we can write both displayed edges E1 and E2 of the triangle as linear combination of the tangent vector and the bitangent vector B. Okay. Right, E1 is, let's have a look. Where's this U1? T. And V1. Okay. Vaguely following that, but we'll just kind of plow on. Which you can auto write as this. I will take your word for it due to lack of time. We can calculate E as the difference vector between the two vector positions, and U and V as texture coordinates, coordinate differences. We're then left with two unknowns, tangent T and bitangent B, and two equations. You might remember from your algebra classes that this allows us to solve for T and B. The last equations allow us to write in a different form. Yes, so we can do matrix multiplications. And so we're creating the same setup as this, apparently down here. Okay, so we've rearranged. Yeah, we wanted the tangent and bitangent. We've reconstructed it out of other information we've already had. And then we've done some rearranging to get to get that isolated. And then we've got this. The final equation gives us a formula for calculating the tangent vector and bitangent vector from a triangle's two edges and its texture coordinates. Don't worry if you don't really understand the math behind this. Good! As long as you understand, I will need to come back and understand this later, but maybe not now. As long as you understand that we can calculate tangent and bitangent from triangles, vertices, and its texture coordinates, then we're halfway there. Oh, we're halfway there. That's good, because we've got half an hour. So let's see if we can do the other half. We took an hour and a half to get the first half done. Now we have half an hour for the last half. I'm sure this will go great. Okay, manual calculation of tangents and bitangents. In this tutorial's demo scene, we had a simple 2D plane looking at the positive Z direction. This time, we'd like to implement normal mapping using tangent space. We can orient this plane however we want and the normal mapping and have the normal mapping still work. Using the previously discussed mathematics, we're going to manually calculate the surface's tangent and bitangent vectors. I mean, one of the things you can do when you import models is a model might have the tangents and bitangents already defined on them, or you can run a pre-process step that does that while you load in. Again, you want to trust that the things are actually producing sane tangents and bitangents, or we can generate them on the fly, but obviously that takes a little bit of work as far as like processing power. I don't mind taking us some time. Okay, so assuming the plane, okay, is made up from the following vectors, 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, and 4, as it's two triangles. We first calculate the triangle's edges and delta UV coordinates. With the required data for calculating tangents and bitangents, we start with the... Oh, wait a second, though. I'm just realizing this is all being done GLM. This is all being done CPU side. Interesting. So we are going to have to calculate some information, and we're going to have to shove it somewhere to go along with these guys. Now, that's going to be interesting, because I just got to think of how we're going to get that data up. But I can guess we can make a second GPU array with the tangents and bitangents, rather than trying to redefine the vertex layout for this stuff. We'll just make another GPU array storing tangent and bitangent and upload those as well. Like, just pass those into the stream. Should work. I'm just trying to think of how we can do that in time while keeping everything running. So we're doing some of the basically the math that we had before. Okay, if we calculate the fractional part of the equation as f, and then for each vector component, we do the corresponding matrix multiplication multiplied by f. If you compare this code with the final equation, you can see it's direct translation. At the end, we'll also do a normalization to make sure the tangent bitangent vectors end up as unit vectors. Hey, look. Local axes. Because a triangle is always a flat shape, we only need to calculate the single tangent bitangent pair per triangle, as they will be the same for each of the triangle's vertices. Should be noted that most implementations, e.g. model loaders and terrain generators, generally have triangles that share vertices with other triangles. In this case, developers usually average the vertex properties like normals and tangents, tangents by tangents for each vertex to get a more smooth result. Our plane's triangles also share some vertices, but seen as both triangles are parallel to each other, there's no need to average the results. But it's a good thing to keep in mind whenever you encounter such a situation. That is a good thing to keep in mind. I'm pretty sure our triangles are actually... Nope, they are going to be sharing some vertices. But again, I think we're in the same situation as this chap. I think we'll get away with it. And then we get down to tangent space normal mapping. Okay. Right, let's do this bit first. We need to calculate this stuff. So how are we going to do this? That's going to be interesting, actually. I was wondering if this is going to be kind of feasible to do in the remaining time. Let's have a look at things. And let's have a look at the box. Let's have a look at its stream, because inside it, it will have GPU arrays. And this is what we're interested in. We have one GPU array, which is holding the vertex data, and then we have an index array that's operating over that. Let's bring that down to the REPL, and we're going to pull G. Okay, so we can see those are the points we're working with. And the indices we're working with. So if we iterated over every three of these, that would give us each polygon. Let's see what that would look like. We're gonna make a new file, foo.lisp. In package, play with verts. Let's make a test function. Let's go and just for our test, we're going to get the first out of things. We're going to get the stream, I think. What do we actually call it? I don't know what the accessor. Oh, shit. Wait a second. Cancel. I don't know what the accessor is for stream. It's called buff stream. There it is. Let's get back to the REPL. The buff stream of the first thing. Cool. Buffer stream GPU arrays is going to give us the two GPU arrays we're interested in. Let's take this line and we'll do destructuring bind. We'll have the verts and the indices. Not sure if that's how you spell it. Then we are retrieving those two arrays, putting them in here. Then we can loop for P0, P1, and P2, or V0, V1, V2 for vertex, V1, V2 for, like, now how do we do this? Is it over or on? I think it's on verts by CDDR. Is that going to go by 2 or 3? Let's 1, 2, 3, 4. Never quite remember. CDDR is 3, 4. CDDR. There we go. 4. Yeah, that's what we want. And then we're going to go collect. And let's just try this. Let's just see if we can get groups of 3 vertices. What's it complaining about there? Indices is not used. Correct. We're not using you yet. That's not a problem. That did not do what I thought it was going to do. What's the test function? It's that one. That's cute. Oh, idiot. These are GPU arrays. So gverts and gindices. We need to pull those. Let verts be pull gverts. Indices are pull g indices. Then it didn't like how we were pulling it. Okay, because this is actually a list of things. We only need the first one, so we'll do this. Okay, so now we get groups of 3 vertices. What we can see here is the position, normal, and texture coordinates. Okay, so we have some data here. Okay, so they had what's tricky to me is where are they getting the fourth one from? Are we having to, oh man, we're going to have to look up the, we're having to do this for each plane? Ugh. as it's two triangles. Medians on it, CDDR. Yep. Oh, I think that symbol stands for delta or change. Thanks, Vault 11. Sorry I'm so slow on getting to the chat today. When starting, vario symbol ambient is undefined. I know exactly why that is. Because, come on. Render ambient. Because it is defined down here, but the shaders are being compiled as we go down the page. So it's looking and can't find them. So that will fix that. Yeah. Oh, what we actually need, I'm being daft, aren't I? What we actually need is, for each plane, 3, 4, and 5, we shouldn't be pulling data, like going over the vertices. We should be going over the indices. So then we have, I mean, really it would be, this is the first triangle, and this is the next triangle. So then we can look up the, these are the indices of the points that make up the each pair of triangles. So maybe we can work from that. Assuming his plane is built up with the following vectors, with 1, 2, and 3, and 3, 1, and 4 as its two triangles. Yeah, so you have to kind of hope that we're getting, yeah, 0, 1, and 2, and 0, 2, and 3. But no, this doesn't look right actually. Oh, this looks strange. Oh, now, of course. Now I'm gonna have to, advance by 6, not by 3. So nth CDR, I have to go by 6, I guess. This is not a pretty way of writing this thing, but. Yes, okay, right. So then we're interested in this one, and this one. Seems to be giving us the points we need. Woof, okay. Defun calc. V1, V2, V3 we'll call it. So actually, what are they calling it? Actually, I'm gonna call these, rather than V, it's gonna be I, because these are indices. Click the same here. Okay, and then we're going to get rid of this, and we're going to say calc. I don't think this is happening in the next 15 minutes, that's for sure. But what the fuck? So then we have, let's star pos 0 is, we're going to need to pass in the verts. What we could do actually is for the verts, we can just pull it down to a C array, and then we can get, it's gonna be a little easier to work with if we do it like this. So we'll do verts, I0, I1, oops, 0, I1, I2, I5. Right, and then RFC, because we're using this. Yeah, this might work. Yeah, no, it's fine, 1D. Verts, I0, okay, so then we can just do this, 1, 2, 3, 4. 3, 2, 1, 1, 2, 3, and what do we have here? Let's take this. Right, we have some positions and we have some UV coordinates, so then we want to get the UVs for these guys as well. Let's do that. Oops, come on, fingers. What's going on? There we go. God damn it. UV. Ah, yes, that's something we actually need to do because we're getting hold of the struct here, but we're not extracting the position. So I happen to know it's a GPNT, and then it's a position. And then this one is going to be a GPNT. This is just the name of the type. I guess it's called text. Actually, I'm going to have to go and... I think it was GPNT. Let's have a look. GPNT. Right, yeah. Position, normal, and texture. Terrible name. Again, it was names decided when I was a real noob and didn't know. Knew even less than I know now. So, I hate that naming. Should fix it at some point. Really? Oh, because we've got the accessor, we can just use post-normal text. Is that how that works? I thought we still ended up with GPNT. No, okay, you just end up with the accessors. Oh, right then. Forget it. These ones are pos, and this one is text. Surely we're going to need the normal as well. And we'll need the normal vector from one of them. Okay, cool. That makes sense. So we'll take this. Norm is, we'll take the first one. And we'll take the norm. Okay, that's fine, but we're not using any of these yet. So given that, we have to do... this. Okay, so, oops. Edge one, I don't like that number. Oh, we'll just go with that naming, whatever. Oh, did he name them plus one, two, and of course, it's one based indexing. 1, 2, 3, and 4. I'm gonna follow the naming just because it's gonna get confusing enough anyway. We'll just have to live with that. Okay, so edge one is, that's gonna be a vec 3, so we do v3 minus pos 2, pos 1. Edge 2 is pos 3, pos 1. I think you're right about that delta. It's looking looking very likely. UV2, UV3, UV1, UV1. Let's keep it going. 10 minutes. It's not gonna happen. Not gonna happen. Right. F is 1, divided by minus times the x coordinate of delta uv 1, the y coordinate of delta uv 2, and we subtract that from 2 and 1. Let's move this bar over a little just so we can see a bit more. 1, 2, 2, 1. Yes, we're doing x's and y's respectively. Cool. Right, so then we have these. So we have three rows of something very similar. So we're creating the tangent now. So tangent 1 is v3 normalize of times f. Okay, so we're going to be dealing with, actually this looks kind of similar again. So we got two multiplies and a subtract. So let's just do this. We get the form. So we have delta UV, so the y of delta UV 2 minus the x of edge 1, and then that's minus the y of delta UV 1 minus the x of edge 2. Right, and we have three of these. And what just happened? Oh yes, they're all multiplied by f, so... Oh no, not this. I didn't want that guy. There we go. Times f. Okay, so we've got this. I don't know why that was so fiddly. So it's all of these are UV2y. Okay, so it's the edges that are changing here. So it's x, edge 1, edge 2, x, y, z. Is that right? That looks good. And then we're doing something similar for the bitangent. So all of these first ones are negated. So and they're all x. And they're all x of uv2, so that's right. Then it's times edge 1 xyz, yes. And then we've got delta uv1 x. And these are additions now rather than subtractions. X, x, x. Multiplied by edge 2 xyz. So that's cool. So the last thing here is plus, plus, and plus. Ooh, I didn't like it there. It's cool with three arguments. Yes, it should have been wrapped up in a vector definition. Okay. Yeah, that's a lot of things that weren't used. Where? Oh, fuck, of course. Okay, right. I have to go back and check this now because I fucked that up. Two, one, three, one. Two, one, three, one. 2131, 2131. Okay, so that was there. So POS4 was never used, UV4 was never used. Oh, right, so they don't actually need the whole plane. I wonder why that was the case, but fine. POS4 and UV4. Calculate it for no reason. Right, so we calculate this stuff. And then we have to do the shader. So, but the thing is, we've got a bunch of data now, and we've got to get it somewhere. So we've got tangents and bitangents. That's great. So we're going to need a data type to store this in. So let's def struct d db data, whatever. We don't have time to think about it. Tangent, which is a vec3. Bitangent, which is a vec3. Right, then we're going to return a list of tangent and bitangent. We're going to shut this up by commenting these out. And then it's going to complain that, wait a second, we didn't use norm? That's really funky. What are you talking about, we didn't use norm? Really? Anywhere? Wait, no, we must have. We must have, because you're meant to be calculating. Oh, I suppose, no, I suppose the normal to surface is always going to be, oh, right. Review this another time. Anyway, I3 is defined but never used. Declare, why are you doing this, Chris? Ignore I3. Okay, right, everything's hunky-dory there. Go away. And I will not be pushing this until a little bit later. So when you call this function, it returns a list of two things, which is perfect as arguments for this. So we are going to hope that we can then run test, and hopefully we get some data. That's good. Tangents and bitangents. That should be nice. Then what we're going to do is we're going to take this data. Define them all out of good names. Test 2 takes test. And uses input to make GPU array. This is the initial data, and the dimensions we're not going to specify because it can guess them. And element type is going to be TB data. And then when we do test 2, we've got the data on the GPU. Good, that bit's easy. Then what do we need to do? Then we need to be able to pass this to the pipeline. So let's go to render, let's go down here. Now we're actually going to need to pass more data to the vertex stage. So we actually do need a different vertex stage. In fact, no, we'll just change this vertex stage and the other stage won't use the information. So we're going to change this. So it's going to do TB is going to be TB data. It's going to take it. It's going to then... pass it on to the next stage. So all we'll do is we'll just shove it down here. We'll actually unpack them. TB data, tangent, TB data, bitangent, tangent of TB. TB, do that. Right, now we're going to need two arguments coming into the fragment stages. So let's go have a look at those, which come in here. And they're going to go tangent, which is a vec3, bitangent, which is there. Let's comment that down and let's bring it down to here. Now what? Now we've got these, we're going to have to update our pipelines to let them know that we've changed our how our stage is. Vec2. This now takes a TB data as well as a GPNT, so it's going to do that. Let's do this. What's it going to complain about? Could not find a GPU function. Some frag stage with all these things. So I guess we haven't compiled this yet, because we've definitely got enough there. Oh no, not vec2, sorry, vec3. I think that might have just compiled. We'll see. Yes, no warnings. Brilliant. Okay. So then we'll do this. Oh no, we won't. Vec3. Go on, over here, compile this. I don't want to compile just the word with. It doesn't like this. Outvars from the previous stage don't match. Correct, because this is now taking a TB data as well. Good. Right, so live support continue. Everything's hunky-dory. Except for the fact it's not. We're still running, though. We have not crashed the program just yet. But we do need to pass up some data, because I can't understand actually how this is rendering in any sane way at all. But we'll keep on going with it. So what was that test2 function? Right, let's do def var tb data is that. Okay, so now we have tb data. We should be able to go to, where do we define our buffer stream? Play with verts.lisp here. Okay, so there's a couple of things we can do. We can do this. And set it to nil. We can go in here, fucking anywhere, it really doesn't matter, Chris. We're gonna say free tb data. Oh yeah, when tb data, otherwise we'll run into problems later. And then we can do setf tb data is test2. Sorry, I'm not looking at the chat much. I will get to you guys soon, because I know we're overrunning, but I really want to see how far we can get with this. So we got this TB data, and I know that this, like, when Medayan tries to pull this, it's going to be a fucking nightmare, because we've got stuff in comments and stuff in the wrong files and orders. It's going to need to be fixed. But we'll get there. Stream. Where are streams made? So make... Oops. Make buffer stream. Strange. Where? That's got to be done somewhere. Maybe it's done in assets? Wait, we took a specific asset, didn't we? We only made a buffer stream for this box. So actually, so this is going to be quite funny. There's our buffer stream right here. It's going to end up taking something like list, vert, and TB data, like that. Let's go look at the foo file again. Let's pass in a thing, I guess. Wait a second, this is... It's looking for the buffer stream and gets the arrays. We've got them here, so let's just say that this now... Oh, yeah, this takes... vert and indices. Yeah, okay. We'll do this. Compile this. Do this. Compile this. We'll actually use it. Where are we? I don't know. It's going to be G verts and G indices. So now we don't need to pull them at all. We can just pass them in. We'll do this. G verts. Oh, come on. The indices. Okay, and then this thing is going to be test2 of vert and index. Right, those are two GPU arrays that we already have available. What happens next? Somehow we need to recreate all of this. So these meshes are cached. So let's destroy the cache. And then let's see what happens when we throw a reset at it. This is where it's going to break. Fuck. Okay, test two. Why is it being called with no arguments? Foo. Test... Wait a second, what? Who the hell would be calling test two with no arguments? Oh, I know who'd be calling test two with no arguments. The bloody place we put it. Test... Oops. test two, we were doing TV data like this. No longer. It was a bad idea. Right, okay, so then it redid everything. So if we looked at things now, we should see a box which has a buffer stream of 7 things and its GPU arrays. Now it has 2 GPU arrays in there. Oh, wait though, fuck. That's got... This isn't gonna work. Oh, fuck. It's got one... We can fix it. It's got... Okay, so we've got 6 tangents and bitangent sets for 24 positions. Can we just get... Oh, man, this is going to... I'm pretty sure this is going to be wrong, because... Okay. Can we just return 4 of these? This is... It's not looking hopeful, folks. It is not looking hopeful. Okay, so then when we look at things, we can see a box, we can see it has a stream, we can see it has 2 arrays of the same length, which it's going to be pulling from, and an index array, which informs how to read that data. That bodes well. But then we would need to do this last bit. No, is this it? This is it. Okay. We've got the tangent by tangent in our shader. In our vertex shader's main function, this is where we're going to create it. Cool. So let's just keep plowing on, because I'm just going to check with my partner. It's all right to run on a little longer, if it's okay with you guys. So just bear with me for 1 second. I just don't want to be an ass. 1 second. Boss man, given us the go-ahead, let's keep going. Right, I want to do another 15 minutes and try and get this done. Okay, so we go to the vertex stage that we're sharing between everything. We have the TB data, which we were doing here. So we're actually going to change some things now, because we've got to do this. Let's just do this. There we go. Sorry, I was just trying to get the layout right. Okay, so, no, T0 is going to be normalize, Vec3 is going to be the model times the, why would you use the model there? Which in this case is world space as we multiply with just the model matrix. Oh, that's the model to world matrix. Okay, I got a little confused there. Model to world times model to world. Then we got a Vec4, which is using the... Oh, this is going to get ugly. The tangent. Can we do this? Actually we can't, it just looks too ugly. Let's do that. By tangent. God damn. Country doesn't know how to handle heat, and all of a sudden flies wake up from nowhere. Okay, tangent. By tangent. And I'm meant to be putting a zero at the end of these. And... oh, then it wants them down as a... okay, it wants them down as a... I don't think I've got the overload for Vec 3 that takes down to Vec 4, so we're just going to swizzle them. X, Y, Z. Swizzle. X, Y, Z. Okay, and the last one, which is going to do the normal. N0. Model times Vec 4, a normal. So we're going to say normal. Which is, wait a second, is that going to be the normal? No, that's the normal of the vertex. We're not doing anything else yet. And then once we've got all these things, this is us setting up a basis, which is your three perpendicular normal vectors, forming a basis of your vector space. Mat 3, T0, B0, N0. Let's see if we can get that to compile. Yep, that compiles. So then it's the TBN we're actually going to pass on to the next stage. At this point, we're going to compile. It's going to freak out. Is it not going to freak out? Oh, I'm very surprised. Oh yeah, because it's not running right now. If we do this, it goes away. But that can give us a minute to actually fix things while it breaks, while it's freaking out. Okay, so we're passing a matrix now to the next stage. So it's not tangent by tangent, it's a mat 3. TBN, TBN. Let's do this. Let's go down to the frag stage. Let's do this. Get rid of those Vec 3s, that wasn't actually what we wanted, apparently. It was Mat 3. Okay, with that done, what do we do with the final bit? We've taken this matrix, we've passed it on. We're going to skip all the description and just look at the code. We're going to take the Mat 3. Yeah, it's coming out of the fragment shader, yes, the vertex shader. It's going over to the fragment shader. Get to the point. Okay. We remap, and then we just multiply by the TBN. Okay. So here, all we have to do is where we get norm to map this fit here. And this is where it's going to go wrong, because we just did way too many assumption hacks, but it was worth a try. Let's see what the function called normal was found in this environment. Where does it think there's something? Probably here. Yeah, not norm TB, we're just meant to be using normal. Okay, oh, wait. That looks correct. Why does that look correct? Dudes, did we just get it right? There's no way we could have done that much hacky shit and get it right. There's just no fucking way. One second. That could have been kind of cool. I want to fuck with these lights individually. I'm just going to take them out of the loop. And there's no way that worked. That was way too much hacking for that to actually happen. Aref, let's do Aref 0 and Aref 1. And we're just gonna, we're gonna not pass in now to this. We're gonna go and calculate, and we're gonna pass in a Vec 3 instead. This is gonna be the offset. And we're gonna do this. Offset, there we go. Right, now this one is the one over here, so we're going to move that up and down. So we'll do V1, zero sine now times, oops, times 5, and then plus a bit as well. So we got plus 8 or something like that. And then we go 0. And then down here, we're going to do it slightly differently because we want to be traversing laterally. And we compile it. And it looks a bit flat, but it's a bit hard to see on this one. Let's where's our exposure? Yeah, I wonder. On the fall off to be stronger, to be honest. I wonder if we turn the, can we turn this down and turn the brightness up? Not sure. What happens if we do that? Play with verbs.lisp. Where are our lights? Light data, down here. What happens if we do reset now? Eh, not much. Fucking idiot, never mind. What we could do actually, we could just lower them down a bit. Where's render? There we go. That kind of looks like it worked. That is not expected. What is going on? I'm seeing normal mapping, which is working despite that direction. Huh. Just to make sure that I'm not being an idiot. Yeah, that's broken. And that's with our extra work. All right. Well, I can't say I understand. Well, no. I mean, like, fundamentally, I get the idea, but I haven't read that math that we just did properly. So I don't really know how it's doing what it's doing. I mean, we made an orthonormal basis. We made a math. So we could create a matrix out of that. And then we transformed the normal based on that matrix. All of that makes sense to me. But what I really need to do to get like proper insight out of this is to go through this stuff and to be honest, all of this stuff, and look at just go through this stuff and work out why it works, and just make sure I can map it up into my head with this stuff, which, to be honest, I find the code way easier to read than this, but I really want to be able to map it to this and just get the intuition of why they did it like this, because I want to be able to teach it rather than just hack this out really fast. But that's fun. That's really cool. And then it goes on to load in more complex objects and stuff like that, which we might do some stream. Object loading is like a minefield. Like, there are good libraries to do it, but then you're as soon as you're getting into that kind of stuff, you start making all kinds of decisions which get very engine-y. But we're getting that way, to be honest, anyway. As soon as we start having like materials that we need for our different pipelines. Okay. Well, thank you so much. Before we wind up, you guys can ask questions. I'm going to just try and fix up this horrible code mess that I just made. Because foo is... Well, foo needs to be added to the build, for a start. I mean, it's a terrible name, but it's what we've got, so... I'm just going to try and clean this up so we can build from scratch. Okay, so we did a load of transforms. We made this stuff. Let's have a look at the changes. We've got foo. We've got the ASD, which now has foo in it. We've got this, which we just changed some values. This is where we actually added the shader code to do different things. Some of our fudging. And this is not how it should be. And this is where we used our hack. Okay. Hackety hack. Right, and just before I push that, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to kill the session, restart, because this is what, like, when other folks pull this code, when Metagame pulls this code, if I've got the order of things wrong, it'll just not work. And there could be some stuff that I've, like, left variables around from the REPL and all kinds of garbage, because we were not being safe. Question, what about a bell? How would it work? If you can tell me how that how we can set that up in a way that makes sense, I'm down to it, man. I'm open to it. Obviously, we're gonna have to have it done in such a way that it's not just used to spam the stream, but like me, I think all you folks are awesome, so I doubt that's gonna be a problem. Okay, so here's an issue. Calc light, was looking for an overload that takes a float. Okay, so if we look in render, calc light, this one. Okay, yeah. Like originally we were passing in a float, and now we can just pass in, because it's a vec3 now this takes, I think. Yeah. We can just pass in 0, 0, 0, because we've got no offset that we're doing in the in this frag stage. I mean, I suppose it really should have the same as the other one, but it's not right now. We haven't got any objects in the scene that don't have normals, so it's not going to be an issue. Yeah. Ugh. It's not good, but as long as we can... as long as we can build it and get it just to run, then that's enough for the stream. Twitch has alerts, I guess. Yeah, I guess I just need to attach, like, I can hook this machine up to speakers and stuff, so I can do that. Yeah. All right. Yeah, we can probably make this work. Oh, my head's gone now. That was an unexpected final result, to be honest. Okay, so now we're going to get a different issue, probably. Okay, so it's super blurry, but that makes sense. Because what happens is when this starts, it creates the FBO with whatever the size of the viewport is. And just because of the way things are set up, I think that's a very low resolution. So what I have to do now is just call reset once, and then it's gonna... By now, it's got the actual size of the surface. So yeah, it just recreates the FBOs to the right size. It's hacky, but like obviously in a game, you just do it like when the window resizes, then you recreate all your FBOs and stuff like that. Normal mapping. Huh. But I'm not confident with those tangents. I'm really not confident at all. It is very interesting. But yeah. Awesome. Alright, where are we now? So I could also join the Twitch chat from Emacs with ERC and then do notifications notified. That's not a bad idea. Pornobim's just pointing out, yeah, no one's been bad. That's the thing, like, I don't think there's been any problems there. So yes, that'll be something to look into. I'll see if I get time to look into that in the next week. The next couple of days, I'm meeting up with my partner in crime, who I'm making the game with. So I'm out of town. Then I'll be back. Then I really want to get on Sunday. What am I doing? Sunday. Me and my partner doing some stuff. I want to try and get some bugs fixed in Keppel. I might be able to do that in the evening someday as well. Not really sure. So yeah. We'll see how that goes. Great. Well, thank you so much, guys. Thank you for sticking around for this extra long stream. Thanks for just bearing with as we kind of hack this out. That was cool. I'm still surprised that we got something that works at the end. Oh, push. Gotta push. Hackety hack. And with that, we are done. Thank you once again. I will catch you next week. Peace.